coming, Major. I take it easy, Billy. Remember yesterday morning, you almost strangled.
Yeah, I know.
Major, Wait up! Oh,
what are you?
Wake up!
Major! Oh, what in tarnation are you two halfwits trying to do anyway?
Trying to save you from the Indians, but the next time I'm gonna stay in that bed and let them scalp you!
Yeah!
Well, are you all packed like I told you?
Packed? You made us pack last night before you made us go to bed. This is the worst last night we've ever spent in San Francisco.
You'll be thanking me for it later on in the day. Now, get moving. Come in!
Finish your nightmare, Major?
What are you doing up and all dressed? Haven't you been to bed yet?
Yeah. Been reading about us.
Us?
West, young man, said Horace Greeley, and his words came thundering out of the newspaper aimed straight for me. And all at once, a boyhood longing assumed a form and a destination, and I saw myself in buckskins on a noble animal, part of a heroic cavalcade. Well, that's as reasonable an explanation as I can give for Aunt Em and I joining Seth Adams' wagon train in St. Louis. We'd pooled our resources to take the old family printing press west. Like most greenhorns, I arrive in St. Louis, absolutely fat with ignorance. I was eager to be taken, and the St. Louis merchants were happy to oblige. They got rid of things they'd had on their shelves for years. It isn't easy being a greenhorn. It takes real work. And believe me, I worked at it. I thought I was a confirmed bachelor, but when I met Melanie, the world suddenly had a whole new dimension. I've been told everyone on the train was at the dance that night. As far as I can remember, there was no one there but Melanie. Pretty brown eyes are looking at you. Pretty brown eyes are looking at you. Pretty brown eyes are looking at you. Skip to Maloo, my darling. Skip to Maloo, my darling. Skip to Maloo, my darling.
I now pronounce you man and wife. And those whom God hath joined together, let no man put asunder. Sam and Melanie, you're joining together at the beginning of a long journey. And those of us who are going to travel with you all those miles, well, we can't give you the gifts that are usually given to a bridal couple, like household goods. Even if we could, Sam hasn't got a spare inch of space in that wagon to put it in. And so we offer you the things that take no space and have no weight. Friendship and affection and prayers for your happiness. And we wish for you all the things that make life good. and a growing love, one that grows and grows and makes all things endurable and good. Well, aren't you going to kiss her, Sam?
I set up housekeeping on wheels and started for the horizon. And all America was spread out around us in beauty and glory. And I felt like a man who had just come into a kingdom. The greenhorn learns rather quickly who his true friends are. I took 6 horses west, and one thing I've got to say for them, from the beginning they were absolutely honest. They made it perfectly plain they were going to do everything in their power to make things just as tough as they could.
Now pick up that horse's left hind foot, will you? Evans, don't you know the rear end of a horse from the front?
Yes, sir. That's the end I know best.
Well, then, will you please pick up his hoof?
Look, now, don't you get smart, because...
Oh. Evans, you can't reach him from there.
Well, he can't reach me from there either, Major.
Come on now, do it, will you?
Well, if he'll give it to me, I'll...
Oh, let me show you here. Oh, son. Come here. Come here. Now, you hold his hook on your leg here like this so you can work on it, you understand?
Yes, sir.
That clear to you?
I see it.
All right, then.
I see it.
Oh.
He's on the foot. He's on my foot. Get him off.
Get over.
Get him off my foot.
Get over.
Get him over. Ooh. Oh, that'd kill me. Major? Major, I'm all through.
All right, sir. Let's take a look. Ooh, son. Hey, Sam, you did a pretty good job. You did all right.
Well, it took me 7 hours.
Well, it won't take you near so long once you get the hang of it, Sam.
I've got 6 horses. That's 24 hooves. Every 4 weeks, I've got a... Shoot 24 hooves.
It's all part of going west, my boy.
Going west? I may not ever see the west. If my horses have anything to say about it. Oh, why couldn't I have bought some oxen or some mules? Or why didn't I just stay home?
Sam, dear, is that you?
Yes, honey, it's me.
Sam, that's why you didn't stay home.
Have the tub full of hot water, and you can soak as long as you want to. You look so tired.
You know, Major, she could have had any man she wanted on the train, and she had to pick out one who can't even shoe a horse.
Well, my goodness, you can't know everything. You'd be so smart, nobody'd be able to bear you.
Well, you kids go on. I'll take care of your horse for you.
Oh, thank you. Thank you, sir. Say, Major... It isn't unreasonable, is it, to actually hate a horse?
Yes, Sam, it is. But in some cases, it's understandable. Now, go on, get out of here.
I'm relieving you, Ed. I wish I could say that eventually the horse and I became friends, the way Flint and his horse were friends. Or a team, the way Bill and his horse were a team, but the best I ever managed with Lucifer, Satan, Mephistopheles, Old Scratch, Old Nick, and Beetlebob was a kind of, well, uneasy peace. They tried to kill me whenever they had a chance. It wasn't safe to turn my back for even a minute.
Stop that!
The major sent me out to spell you for a while, Sam. He wants you to... Hey, what happened to you?
Skip it, Charlie. Come around these horses and everything. Get him away from me now. I know, but get him away there. I don't trust none of them. Come on now.
Ain't you gonna ride back to camp?
I'm not gonna sit on that. Come on now. Come on now here. You ain't gonna follow straight.
Never mind about me. What about those fellas who were chasing you?
You and them two back there?
Yeah.
Oh, they've been chasing me ever since they left town. But they're going to have a long walk back. You can bet on that.
Yeah, well, I was just on my way to help you.
Well, what happened to you? Where were you?
My horse shot me.
Your horse shot
me? Now, don't laugh at me.
I'm not laughing at you, but you know it serves me right for asking.
Oh, come on. Come on. Come on.
It was all very humiliating. We'd only been on the trail a few weeks, and already my horse was a better shot than I was. My eyes saw wonder everywhere, for the golden touch of summer had cast its spell on valley and on mountain, and Melanie's laughter was a silken ribbon tying up the hours. Here, in the soft haze of summer, even my horses mellowed into a certain tolerance. You know, all greenhorns expect trouble with the Indians. In the dark hours of the night, many a brave man breaks out in a cold sweat at the thought of a scalping knife. And many a quiet midnight is shattered by the piercing scream of a slumbering Indian fighter. We were prepared to face Indians, all right, but somehow, not the kind of Indians Major Adams was doing his best to prepare us to face.
Now, folks, we've got a peace treaty with the Indians in this part of the country, and they're not warlike by nature. But I want to tell you one thing about them. These Indians are notorious thieves. They'll steal any gol darn thing they can get their hands on. So the next few days, when we double the guards, I don't want it to worry you. You just keep your wagons closed up tight, and above all things, don't go wandering off by yourselves. Now, is that clear? All right.
See anybody?
Oh. They behind trees now. You ride fast, help Indian brother?
No. Me no do that. Me belong to the wagon train there. Major say me stay with train.
Me Black Feather, me blood brother of Major Adams.
Oh, well, me glad to know you there. Black Feather. But me no Indian, me know no country. Me no can help you.
How you say?
Me know no country. Me no help you, see?
What language you speak?
Me speak English.
You no speak very good.
Look, you go on up to the head of the train and you talk to Major Adams and he tell you what to do.
Me go see Major Adams.
Good.
Thank you.
Just what in tarnation are you doing way back here on foot? What happened? Did your horse throw you again?
No, not my horse. Say, do you have an Indian blood brother by the name of Black Feather?
Did he tell you that two white men stole his horse?
Why, yes. Do you know him?
No, I don't know him. Come on, get up here behind me. Sam, how many times have I told you not to talk to strange Indians?
I didn't talk to him. He talked to me. And then I told him to go up the front of the train and for him to talk to you.
You swallowed the oldest tale there is on the plains. Two white men stole my horse. He never had a horse this heel.
Well, he has one now.
Help! Help! Two white men stole my horse!
Let's get out of here before I lose my horse.
The position of a young brave in his tribe is determined in part by how many horses he's got and how many of the white man's belongings he's been able to, shall we say, accumulate. Now, the Indians around here place a great store on our clothes, and naturally we're his only source of supply. So don't let yourself get lured away from the protection of the train. Well, there's one thing that I want you to remember. I don't want you to trust your ears. By that I mean that the things that you hear are not necessarily what they seem to be. For instance, that could be a whippoorwill. But it could be an Indian signaling that there was a wagon that was unguarded. Now, Indians aren't stupid. They know that a turkey is good bait for a hungry traveler. Now, the point is that a bird or is that an Indian? The main thing I want you to remember is don't ride away after a bird that you don't see, because you might be riding right into an ambush.
Right.
Turkeys. Wouldn't one of those be good for dinner?
Oh, I sure would fancy a juicy drumstick right now.
Well, we aren't going to have any. Remember what Flint said? Never trust a turkey. He may be an Indian. Billy! I hear a pig. I swear I do.
Well, I was just thinking the same thing.
Roast pork.
You said about...
But what about what Mr. McCullough said?
Oh, he was just referring to birds. Yeah. He didn't say anything about pigs. Here, Melanie, you take these reins. I'm going to take a look.
Sam.
Here, just take the reins now. Hang on a second.
Thank you. head. What are you shooting for? What if I was an Indian? You want to start an Indian war or something? And Aunt Melanie. Woo, it's me.
Oh, yes. Sam and I have always been very close ever since he first came to live with me. Why, I'd wake right up in the middle of the night if something was wrong with him.
I'm here in the bushes.
Ooh, I'm working up quite an appetite. Won't that roast pork taste good?
Mm-hmm.
You know, Sam ought to be showing up pretty soon.
They see me coming. They got me right where they want me.
Well, I warned you about the trick, Sam.
Well, you warned me about birds. You didn't say anything about animals.
Well, you come around tonight. Tonight I give a lecture about animals.
Thanks a lot. Oh, I should have stayed in the East where I could hide my stupidity in a barrel. That's me, Sam Stupid. Major hasn't spoken to me for a couple of days. Not that I blame him. I lost my spare horses. Every time an Indian sees me, wham!
Well, Sam, how do you feel?
Like a fool.
Don't let that worry you, Sam. You got a lot of other people along with you. You're all greenhorns.
Well, they're all amateurs compared to me. Nobody did a fool thing like I did.
No, I must admit that everybody picked something different.
Major, answer me one question. How can you stand all of us?
Well, it is a little hard sometimes, isn't it, Flint?
Yeah, but one thing is never dull.
You know, Major, maybe I didn't know about Indians when I first joined up with this train, but I'll tell you one thing.
Oh, what's that?
No Indian is ever going to take advantage of me again. Never again.
Major wants you back at the Elliott wagon. I'll take your place in the line.
Well, I just keep heading them into the sun, will you?
Right.
Right, Bill.
All right, Charlie, keep heading them into the sun. Come on.
I don't care who you are. You've got to get a special feeling when you ride up front, alone. I was leading my forces across the wilderness. I was America. On my way west, I was unconquerable.
With white man.
Him chief of wagon train.
We not want trouble with wagon train.
They're rich wagon train. Pay big ransom.
Take message to train. Tell them their leader accidentally our prisoner. Tell them send someone. Talk terms. Cut white man's bonds. No way to treat white chief.
Mm-hmm.
Prisoner.
Yes. You pay ransom?
I'd like to see him first.
Come.
Is this the way Grego keeps his treaty with the white men?
Somebody. White man, hard to handle. Must come from very stubborn tribe.
Yeah, they call it Irish. Sam. Sam? Sam.
Hmm?
Sam.
Where's Flint?
Yeah.
Where? Where are you? No, you're not the one. Get down!
Let me get this straight. You want 24 rifles, 12 cases of ammunition, 6 horses, and 4 women. That all?
You are prepared to pay more?
I'm prepared to pay 2 strings of beads.
For chief of wagon train?
No, for the chief I'd pay 4 strings. For him, you get 2.
He, no chief.
He's just traveling with a train, and he can't possibly scrape up 6 horses. He's already lost 3 of his team.
Surely he must be worth more than 2 strings of beads.
2 strings of beads, and make up your mind because I'm leaving.
I accept. Cut white man down.
Two strings of beads, huh? I'll punch you in your beads.
That's enough, Sam. Get on your horse. You'll be lucky to get out of here.
We go get them.
No. No, do not want white man. Let white man go.
I let go. But first I bring back scalp.
No, no. White man only worth 2 strings of beads. Not worth war with all white men. Before you take other prisoner, you find out tribe. Never take Irish tribe again!
You're not being reasonable, Sam. The land belongs to the Indians. If anybody's intruding, it's us.
We're trying to make excuses for him.
I'm not making excuses for him. I'm telling you the facts. Look at it this way. We ride across their land. We got horses. We have food. We have all the provisions we need. Everything that they want. Now, you can't blame them. I mean, it's hard to get mad at them for trying to get those things.
Well, it's not hard for me. They stole my horses. Stole my saddle. Stole my clothes. Stole the horse that Major Adams lent to me. And on top of it, they stole me. They've had it in for me ever since I left St. Joe.
Sam, believe me, it's not personal.
No, not personal to you, because you weren't left in the bulrushes without a gun or a fig leaf. I tell you, Flint, I'm fed up to here. I'm finished with them. I'm going to kill every one of them. That's what I'm going to do. I'm going to kill them.
You're not going back to
Sam. Now, look, Flint, this is my fight.
I hated to do that, Sam.
And in this manner, the Indian Wars of Samuel T. Evans passed into history. By the time I was fully conscious, we were out of Blackfeather's territory. When the Western saga is finally committed to history books, and the deeds of giants condensed into paragraphs, the thousands who followed them will be unsung and unremembered.
But let me tell you, we suffered, and we suffered ingloriously. No one ever sings a song to a waterlogged hero. And no one ever eulogizes the man melting away drop by drop in the western sweatbox of August. No mention will be made of those who kept watch on the icy summits, or those who braced themselves against the wind and the dust, moving a foot forward and falling 3 feet back. Go west, young man, wrote Horace Greeley in his nice, snug newspaper office. I wish he'd been with us. But from these hardships came a new sense of values. Small things, always taken for granted, assumed importance. The shade of friendly trees, the gentleness of green meadows, the cool invitation of mountain streams, the sudden absence of torment made all that we looked upon beautiful and good. Looking back now, I can see that I was in a constant state of agitation about one thing or another every mile of the way. That's the only excuse I can give for being so dense about Melanie.
Sam.
Oh, honey, I gotta get this bridle fixed.
Melanie, have you told Sam?
Oh, I've tried, but he has so much on his mind right now.
Oh, and I thought you were going to tell him last night, right after dinner.
Well, I was, but he fell asleep.
Oh, Sam can be so thick-headed sometimes. Well, if you wait long enough, you won't have to tell him.
Oh, Aunt Em. Do you think he'll be happy about it, Aunt Em?
Happy? Why, child, he'll think his cup runs over.
Good evening, Melanie.
Evening, Major.
You like some coffee?
Oh, no, thank you.
Is that Melanie out there?
Yes, it is, Nosy. Come on, sit down a minute, honey. Thank you. How you feeling?
Oh, I never felt better.
You know something? You never looked better in your life. Have you told Sam yet?
Well, I haven't told anyone but Aunt Em. How did you know?
Well, honey, you probably don't realize it, but you look different. There's kind of a glow about you, like a light was shining from inside you.
Well, now, don't say anything until Sam knows.
Oh, of course not.
Here's a cup of fresh milk. Now, you drink every drop of it.
Oh, I'm not hungry, Charlie.
Never you mind. Maybe somebody else not a million miles away just might be hungry. You gotta drink a lot of milk, you know.
Oh, Charlie, you know, too?
Sure, I know. I'm not stupid, you know. It doesn't take a house to fall on me.
Now, Charlie, don't tell anybody.
I'm not going to tell anybody, but these things get out, you know.
Yeah, but she hasn't even told Sam yet.
Now, don't tell me that he's going to be surprised.
Evening, Melanie. Mrs. Hawkins gave me these 4 eggs and said for you to eat them all by yourself, and she also sent over her congratulations. Well, what's the matter? Didn't you know?
I know, it's kind of hard to keep this kind of a secret, honey, from the whole wagon train. Everybody lives so close together. Young couple starting out, well, sort of like they're living their own love story all over again. You know, these people are always going to be a jump or two ahead of you.
Everyone knows but Sam.
Don't you worry, he's going to find out about it, too.
Yes, he is.
Oh!
Something the matter, Sam?
I don't know, honey. Lately, every morning I seem to wake up sort of sick to my stomach.
Hey, Sam.
Yeah.
Bill just caught a couple of raccoons. I'll give you one to cook for supper tonight.
Raccoon?
Yeah.
Well, I don't think Melanie would know how to prepare a raccoon.
Why don't you cook it for her and surprise her?
Me cook it? I don't think I could boil water without burning it.
Well, it's about time you learned to cook. You're going to be a family man one of these days, and babies want to eat when they want to eat.
I don't think babies would enjoy raccoon. I
Can't say I would either.
Did you ever taste any?
No, I never did.
You'll love it, Sam. Very simple to prepare. Just skin it. Kind of spread it out like that and wash it down the inside. If you got any water, if you don't have water, just throw it in the pot. Got to boil it anyway. In fact, you got to parboil it for about 2 hours to get that musky smell out of them anyway.
Yeah, well, don't tell
and
me.
And then while they're boiling, you just throw the potatoes in or onions in and you have them let them bubble. And while it's bubbling, you go out and take yourself about a 10-mile hike. That's to work up an appetite. When you come back, you just pull that little old man out, tear him apart. Mmm, can't you just taste it? There's nothing tastes like raccoon stew. Nothing. He must be off his feet a little bit.
Sam, what's the matter with you?
Well, he's telling me all about bubbling.
Charlie.
Yes, sir?
Did you catch another raccoon?
No, sir, I didn't. Nope. Bill did.
You take that stuff out and bury it.
A raccoon?
Bury it!
Yes, sir.
Take it now.
You haven't tried it, though, have you?
I'll try you.
Yes, sir.
Dinner's almost ready, Sam. We're making a lovely stew.
Please, Melanie. I'm not too hungry.
Sam, don't go inside. I want to talk to you.
I have to go in and lie down, dear.
But...
I just want to lie down.
Maybe you ought to write him a letter.
Maybe I'll have to.
Oh. Ow.
Sam.
Yeah, honey.
Look.
That's very pretty, honey.
It's a baby sweater.
Yes, I see. It's very pretty.
Aren't you going to ask me who it's for?
Melanie, where does this double tree hammer go?
Sam, don't you want to know who the baby sweater's for?
All I want to know right now is where this double tree hammer goes.
The baby sweater's for you.
The kingpin is there. Queenpin. For me? Well, it's a little small for me, isn't it?
Oh, Sam, you're so dumb.
Oh, wait. Honey, I'm sorry. I know I'm dumb, but you don't have to cry about it.
I've been trying to tell you for weeks.
Trying to tell me what?
That you're going to have a baby.
Oh, Melanie, look, men don't have the...
Oh.
A baby. Baby. Melanie, you mean that we're going to have a baby? Oh, gosh. Well, look, sit down. Sit down a minute. I mean, I'll get you a pillow, or shouldn't you be eating something special, Melanie?
Oh, no, dear. Everyone on the train's been stuffing me.
You mean everybody on the train knew about it, and you didn't tell me?
Well, I didn't have to tell anyone. They just seemed to know.
Gosh, what a chowderhead I am. When, Melanie?
I think September.
September, huh? Oh, wait a minute. No, that's no good. We won't be in Sacramento by then.
Well, that doesn't matter, Sam.
Oh, sure it does. I'm not going to let you have a baby on the wagon train here.
Why not?
Well, honey, if anything ever happened to you, I just wouldn't know what to do.
Oh, you always said not to be afraid of life, Sam.
Now, that was before I found out about how many things in life there are to be afraid of.
I was always afraid until I married you. Isn't life funny? You married me and now you're afraid. And I'm not afraid of anything.
Melanie? Honey, you sleep?
No, dear.
I was just thinking about our baby. I hope she has beautiful blue eyes just like yours. And that she has a beautiful smile like yours. I hope she's beautiful just like you are.
Sam, I'm going to have a son.
And she's going to have a good education, too, Melanie. She'll go to grammar school, to high school, and she'll have a good college education.
I'm going to have a son. It's best to have a boy first.
And one day she'll meet a fella, nice fella, and
She'll get married and she'll have some children, too. And we'll be grandparents.
Hold it, Sam. You're going too fast. Tell me, are the grandchildren going to be girls, too?
I'm afraid I can't tell that, Hattie. Melanie, would you mind very much if we left the wagon train at Denver?
Why?
I'm not sure I want you to have the baby in the wagon.
Now listen to me. We met among the people on this train. We began our life together with them. I think it's appropriate and wonderful that our child should be born among these friends. Oh, Sam, we won't leave the train in Denver, will we?
How could I say no to you, Melanie? I started west along with Aunt Em. Now I had friends, a wife, and a heart full of dreams. I apologize to Horace Greeley for the remarks made in an earlier chapter. The long journey was almost behind us now. We rode through a morning laced with the spice of pine and cedar. We craned our necks to see the lofty tops of redwood trees that looked down on man and up to God, the oldest living things on earth. Giants of the forest that were already old when Christ was born. I remember Melanie saying as we started down the shaggy sides of the mountain that surely there had never been a more beautiful morning. And then in one shattering moment, disaster.
Give us room to work. Bring up that team, will you? Sam, I have to ask you to do something that's not going to be easy for you to do.
Anything, Major.
I want you to stay right here while Flint and I go down there and see what the situation is.
But Major Melanie's my wife. I want to be down there with her.
Sam, I understand exactly how you feel. And this decision's going to be entirely up to you. But I wish you'd trust us to go down there and see what we can do for Melanie.
You're right, Major. Flint would be more help.
Thanks. I hoped you'd say that.
All right, make it faster. One each wheel, boys.
Set, Flint?
Yeah.
All right, let's go.
Pay it out easy.
Make your line. What? Those kinks,
easy. It won't take much to send it over.
Yeah, I see. Bill! Send me down a couple of good big ropes. We gotta tie off this wagon. Hey! Melody! Melody! Major! All right, let him come. Send him down. Wagon, Flint. Get her up on top.
Well, maybe I could carry her.
Hold on a minute. I don't want to take a chance on taking her up that way. We're gonna have to get a litter. Pick me up! Easy! All right, hold it! Sam!
Here, take the rope.
Yes, sir!
Melanie's still alive! She's hurt! But she's still alive.
Ox, send us down a litter.
Hurry up about it. You all set there, Flint?
Yeah, I'm secure here.
All right, take up your slack on my rope.
Pull up on mine.
All right, now pull all of us up together.
All right, take him away real easy now.
You got it?
Yeah. Slowly!
Thank you.
Yes, you are. All right. Melanie! She ain't gonna die, is she, Major?
I don't think so.
Oh, Aunt Em.
Major, we gotta get her into a wagon.
Bill, give me a hand here.
Major,
when you call one of the women, I'll need help.
Aunt Em, this is not the first baby I've helped into the world.
Baby?
But, easy, Sam.
But it's not time yet.
God tells you when it's time.
Thanks. You know, I feel so completely helpless sitting around like this.
I know.
You know. How could you know? You've never been through this before.
Just about 100 times, that's all.
What?
Yeah, if I'm around, every time there's a baby due, well, I pace the campfire with the expected father.
Oh, yeah. I understand. You keep us in a corner somewhere, out of the way from everybody, huh? Hey, what's that?
Hot water.
What for?
Major wants it.
Can I help you with it?
No, I gotta do it.
No, I gotta do it. See, I can't even help with the hot water.
Well, the Major's pretty easy to time like this. You don't want to do anything to upset him.
Yeah, I don't want to upset him. I just want to know what's going on, that's all. Hey, what's that?
Full water, Sam.
For what?
Major wants to have it handy.
Well, can I help you with it?
No, he wants you to stay out here.
Well, look, it's my baby.
Not till he turns it over to you, it isn't.
You know, my life is in that wagon, my wife and my baby. Flint, I just can't stand around out here and do nothing.
Nothing to do, Sam. You know, Sacramento's a good town to start a paper in, growing every day. You planning on a weekly?
Huh?
Hmm? I said, are you planning on a weekly?
Oh, yes, yeah. Monthly would be safer, but you can't get the news as fresh that way, so we're going to try something new.
Well, I think Sacramento can support a weekly. Sit down.
The baby's dead. The baby was born dead.
Aunt Em, you just shut up and look after Melanie.
Sorry about, honey.
You wanted a girl.
Oh, that doesn't make any difference. Just as long as you're all right.
It's best to start with a boy.
Oh, best to start with a boy. It looks like you just about called it too, didn't you?
Sam, take a look at the most beautiful boy I ever helped into the world in my life.
Oh, look at him there. Has he got all his fingers and toes?
Don't worry, Sam. He's a perfectly normal boy.
He is. Well, I just wondered, you know, him coming early and all.
Sam, that little fellow was in a hurry to get here. You gotta admire a little boy with an attitude like that.
Yeah. Sure do. Look at him, Melanie.
Sam, he's beautiful. He looks just like you.
Oh, no, he doesn't. Does he?
What are you going to call him?
I think we'll call him Seth.
take care of things. I got work to do.
Ocean.
Oh, Sam, how wonderful to see it at last.
Yeah, new land. Place to send down roots and to grow. For us and for him. And so the miles roll out to the shores of the Western Ocean. And the long trip ends. And we who made that journey file away the memories of laughter, tears and prayers, of the times of challenge and the times of peace. Much will fade mercifully from recollection, but the strong countenances of friends will endure. Charlie, who can always cook his own goose as well as anyone else's. Bill, a strong arm and a steadfast heart. Flint McCullough, wilderness scout, adventurer, wanderer, and the man who puts his dream on wheels every year and takes it west, and every year helps pull this vast, sprawling country a little closer together.
Wagons!
His voice rang out in the morning like a bugle call and a drum roll, and we followed that voice from Kansas to the end of the trail.